Okay, so I'm doing what I always teach my grad students, postdocs, not to talk about the latest thing I did. And not only that, there was some politics in the abstract. And you'll understand what it is. Whenever you do something on a big scale, politics comes to play. And you'll see that in spades in Russia, where politics and money play a very big role, but we'll see what's going on. So I'm going to talk about the Mikhail Lomonosov satellite launch that we just had. And they're still doing the spacecraft checkout. I was hoping, I had the Skype on because I'm hoping to get a message from Moscow about what the current status is right now. We'll see. So in the abstract, I mentioned briefly the science, but then I spent a little more time on the politics. In the talk, I'll mention briefly the science at the beginning, and the first half of the talk will be the politics, but mostly the rocket science. So there is a reason that rocket science is called rocket science. You know, hard things are called rocket science. And you will see the Soviets actually mastered the system very well, but the Russians have fallen on a harder time in later years, but other issues came into being. Okay, so this is a famous portrait of Mikhail Lomonosov. So a little over 300 years ago, he was born in a small town not so far from Archangel, which is up here above the Arctic Circle. And because he was such a smart young man, he got to walk 1,000 miles through the cold snow to Moscow to go to high school. Okay. Yes. Uphill both ways. Okay. No, so he went there. He was such an outstanding student at high school that he was sent to Germany to go to college. So at the time, there were no colleges in Russia. He went to college in Moscow. I mean, he went to college in Germany. He did very well in college. He took very good notes, and he brought back all his textbooks, and he convinced the Empress, the Tsarina, to create a college in Russia, which that college became Moscow State University, which for a time, 25 years ago, was one of the top universities in the world. Right? I don't have quite as high opinion of it. I have a picture of it I'll show you later on or whatever. However, he was born 303 years ago. And so part of the story, and why it's called Mikhail Lomonosov, was that the university, which was called Moscow State University, now is Lomonosov Moscow State University, the rector wanted to have something spectacular that was a big achievement of the university that showed how great they were and how they should keep getting funding or whatever. And at the same time, you'll see I had encouraged some people to think about doing some science, and because they were slow at publishing and getting things done, I said the only way we can do it is make a Pathfinder. We then need to find someone who will fly our Pathfinder without too much trouble and expense so that we can prove that it works. Okay. So there was a congruence of that, and it also turns out that the Russian Federation under Dmitry Medvedev had a program of bringing in top scientists from around the world and giving them mega grants to set up new research facilities and laboratories. And so I did, and with the money the rector got together, plus the influence the rector had, convincing Roscosmos that it should launch us, and the money that I got from the mega grant, we were able to hire 35 people, or perhaps more, but I paid for 35 people, whose job it was to build the spacecraft, this clumsy looking thing that actually goes on the rocket. And so we managed to get that done. And so things happened. Now let's see if I can make this work. This is all background material. So this satellite, so you don't have to read all this. This is just to show you that. The idea behind this satellite was there's a bunch of Russian experiments that people had been wanting to do for some time period. And they were promised if they could get them all working and get approval, they could fly them on the back of some Earth Resources satellite. So there were these instruments that were kind of being prepared, laying around. So when the idea of the satellite came up, the idea was to put all these things on the satellite. Now, that's good and bad. So first I'm going to sidetrack and say why we're interested in gamma ray burst. So over on the left is a picture of the gamma ray sky. And you will watch this point over here. It will go to be as bright as the sky for a time period that's on the scale of a second. So that should give you an idea. So here's the time scale down here. This is a sort of a characteristic burst. But you see here at about time scale here between 3 and 4 seconds, it gets up to where if you had a square meter, you were getting 30,000 particles. Well, it's less than a square meter for this thing. But 30,000 hard X-ray gamma rays going through your detector. That's very impressive. The total amount of energy coming out of that is about equal to the amount of energy that comes out of the sun over its whole life, but it comes out in a second. So this is the by far the most powerful things that happened in the universe since the Big Bang, and even there it's an argument about where you consider the power. And this is about, on the characteristic time scale for supernova, put out roughly this much energy, is on the order of a month, a week to a month, depending on it. So these are still powerful comparatives. So if you ever watch a picture of a galaxy with a supernova going off in it, you look at those, the bright type 1As or the really strong type 2s, they will be about as bright as the rest of the galaxy, but only for a period of a couple of weeks and then fades away. But here, it's all happening on the timescale of a second. So these guys are interesting, and they were particularly interesting, and I'll get back to it after I talk about rocket science and the politics. They are particularly interesting for a thing that just happened for gravity waves. Because there was one thing that, when I would teach the course, it was that we expected binary neutron stars to coalesce. The prediction is they will make gravity waves that advanced LIGO should detect when advanced LIGO gets to the full level sensitivity. But it would also possibly be a source of the short gamma ray bursts, which haven't been observed. OK, so here, pardon my French. Here is the description of the instruments that is actually a little nicer and so forth to see. Here's a picture of it. Here's me in Moscow standing next to a two-thirds scale model of what's going on. The primary experiment on here is the thing they call TUS, which is the GEM-USO precursor. That is, it's a big elliptical mirror made up of hexagonal segments. The hexagonal segments are grooved kind of like a Fresnel lens. It's unfortunately looking at a picture of something that's got lines the other way, so it looks pixelated, but it's not. In this picture, you can see kind of how it looks. And it has a thing that folds down in front of it that's a focal plane, and it images lightning strikes and extensive air showers. And so it's meant to look down. It was going to be an Earth Resources satellite looking down, and there's a issue. So that's what it is here. Here are the mirrors. Here's the thing. That's the one the Russians consider to be the most important one. The gamma ray burst stuff, we're on the other side looking up, because they're looking at the Earth, we're trying to look at the sky, and so forth. And so when we went to them saying we'd like to fly that, they said you can have 20 kilograms and 10 watts. In the end, we got 20.5 kilograms, or 20.5 if you're European, and we got 20 watts. So we did really well. Of course, we couldn't do it for 10 watts, so that's another issue. So here's a picture of the satellite as it's assembled in the M, and you'll see there's three stages in Moscow where you bring your instruments, then they get moved into an even cleaner place, and then they get moved into an even more exacting place before they get moved off. Okay, so this gives you the scale of the whole thing. This is about 500 kilograms total mass. And it has those seven instruments on board and so forth. So one of them, which is not even listed on that one, was on the previous one, is designed to look for whether you can micromanage stuff, which is sort of an ELISA Pathfinder kind of stuff. So let's go back to this, if I can get back here. The IMSS-1 is microelectronics mechanical inertial measuring modules, right? So it's the not astrophysics kind of experiments on there. Okay, so this is the first launch from the Vostochny Cosmodrome. Oh, the E is missing, sorry. And so Vostochny basically means east, and you'll see that as it became on behind schedule and other problems happened, eventually Putin says we will launch on Easter. Now, fortunately, there's two Easters, so there was a little bit of room. But it's basically in this region. Beijing is down here. North Korea is there, so this gives you an idea. It's way in the east, and it's extremely far north. And the reason is, the Russians do almost all their launches out of Kazakhstan, which is also pretty far north, but this is even much more north. So there's an issue there. Okay, so here's what the facility looks like. There are three such launch pads. Only one is finished at this present time. And there is a place for the rocket fumes to go out. There's a water pool down here, and there's a big vent things. And there's a big assembly building that rolls over it. While it's not assembly protective building, the assembly buildings are going to be on either side, and I'll show you some pictures of that. And so you'll see the Russians have engineered this extremely well, and they've taken old Soviet technology, which is extremely outstanding, and they've actually maintained it at a reasonable level. However, they have been, this rocket, this is a Soyuz rocket, this happens to be, the up until 6 years ago, absolutely the most reliable rocket ever made by mankind. And the last 6 years, there have been three failures, right? So there's an issue there. You have to have a good design, you have to have good metallurgy, and you have to have good execution. They screwed up one of those, right? So, okay, so here's a close-up CAD drawing of what the whole thing's look like when it's assembled. This whole building moves out like that, and I'll show you some pictures of that. So the technology is very interesting. I think of this as Putin have built the pyramids for himself, but we'll see. So here's the picture of what it looked like last fall, the satellite photo of the Earth. Sorry. I could turn the sound off for a minute. Just remember when I get to the right things, I'll turn it on. So it wasn't last fall. It wasn't much of anything there. Here's what it looked like last September. So this is the part where the rocket sits. And you'll see there's a complicated set of holders that hold up the rocket. And what's impressive is if you watch the launch, these guys stay blue. Every other launch place I've seen, they have to repaint them because the flames destroy it. So there's some tricky things going on. But you can see the scale of this. I mean, see this crane? See these people down here? This is not small, right? So this is the assembly building pulled back. This is where the thing sits. This down here is where the rocket assembly and the satellite assembly and stuff are done. Here it is a month later, getting a little bit more done. There it is in November. So you can tell. So this is a nice, pretty picture from Roscosmos. They picked the day it snowed and it was clean. And Putin came to town. Well, I thought I turned it off, but I turned off only the local sound, not the faraway sound. So Putin came. This is when he was very upset with them for being behind schedule by a year. And he's been holding up our launch at this point for nearly 3 years because all the launches are from Kazakhstan, and you pay money to Kazakhstan. And Putin has got an argument with Aliyev, with Nureyev, and he doesn't like to pay money, and so science missions got no priority under him. They're under demand. So in the middle of what this was going on, 2 years ago, Putin came back to power, two and some years ago, and he had much less interest in science, partly he didn't push science as much as Mendeleev did, but second of all, it was a chance for him to attack some of the science because he could get some Mendeleev supporters to strengthen his base. And so there's a lot of politics that goes on in this whole thing, including Skoltova Tech that got crunched in this in the middle of it. So here's Putin visiting. Here's the press release, right, of him going to visit this place. Looks pretty good, right? So forth. All right, so here's the headline. So I've been making this talk along the way as we get ready for the launch. And so here was the headline that came out one of the days. This was the one that was slightly critical. So Vostochny is getting ready for the first launch and for the long holidays. Right? So these guys are secretly hitting that it's not going to be operational until 2017 or 2018. However, one of the launch pads, the Soyuz launch pad, the Proton launch pad is not ready. And the other, they have a Dnieper, and they have one other new one they're trying to make. Not going to be ready, but they're going to launch us on April 27th of 2016, and it'll be our satellite. So this is the first time we started taking it seriously, that we're going to, because, okay, well, if you don't think science is important enough to launch, pay money to launch, you can use it as fodder for testing a new new facility. Plus, it's much better press to have your first launch at your new facility, you be a civilian, interesting launch, right? So there's a little politics goes on. There's a backstory that goes on this. There's a big backstory that goes on for this kind of stuff. So assembly of the rocket started on January 20th. So they were getting more serious. And they did a rollout, which I'll show you some pictures of, on March 21st before they did the rollout at the end of April, right? So you'll see there's two sets of pictures I have, one of the first rollout, one of the second rollout, and so forth. So There's a second issue which you can look for. Let's see if I have it. What you will look for, well, this looks like a great site. It looks pretty good. There are even lights for stuff at night and so forth. One of the reasons it's going to take a long time is even though the astronauts go to the space station on the Soyuz, this is in the Siberian forest, and the cosmodrome, the Baikonur cosmodrome, is in the steppes. So if your rocket doesn't go up very far, you can see wherever the astronauts land from far away. In the forest, not so easy. It's hard to get there and recover them very quickly. So you can't afford a mistake, right? And so they're going to have to do a bunch of things in order to be ready to launch astronauts to the space station. But so that's an issue. Okay, so here's give you an idea what things look like about a month ago. So the Russians have drones too. And this shows you what the facility looks like. That's the building that goes around the rocket when it's ready. Here are the buildings where the satellite and the rocket are actually assembled. This is different from most launch facilities. Usually there's a separate building where the rocket's assembled vertically and the satellite is moved in and put on top of it, and it rolls vertically all the way to the launch site. This goes horizontally and is erected at the end. But you can see the scale of this. And remember, there's going to be three of these. There are three sets of these that are spread out. And this building is extremely tall. You'll see that in a couple of the pictures. So it's not trivial just to move this stuff around. So there is rocket science to rocket science. It's pretty complicated. There you see the buildings. The Russians, like the Chinese, like to have really big buildings for different reasons, right? But why do you usually assemble your rockets in remote buildings? Well, because sometimes rockets blow up, and the building wouldn't be in such good shape. Okay, so here's the rocket assembly building, and this is our rocket being assembled. This is the first stage. This is the second stage, and the third stage is starting to be prepared out there. One of the things you'll notice if you look carefully is this rocket, the bottom is small and the top is big. Surprise, but that's actually some smartness that they've done. Okay, so here's the test rollout. Okay, so now there are four boosters on it, but you can see that this is a smaller part now has the big boosters on it, so it's bigger. There's a middle section, and this is a great huge thing. So on this launch, there's our satellite, which is 500 kilograms. There's another satellite, which is about half that size, and then three CubeSats that are in there. And they each get dropped to a different orbit. Right? Each set gets dropped to a different orbit. And then you can see the gantry and so forth. So this is on this rolling cart that comes out, and then it's erected to go up and top. Right? So it's a tricky operation. You see it's going up there. And then I have a movie to show you what it looks like. And then the building gets rolled forward. And so you can see the building looking up at the rocket from the building. And this is another picture of what it looks like for that test rollout. So lots of pictures. And here's a movie. So this is a Roscosmos movie. And this is Baikonur, not Baikonur, Postochny. I have no control. Sorry about that. The volume is controlled by the. So you can see it's a little messier now. And the rocket's pulled out of the main building and it passes through the standing building and goes out to the launch pad. So this says Vostochny Cosmodrome, and then it says launch the basically boost to the heavens. So you see the people for scale. And you can also see the vent bowl. So earlier, so it's not lifted up that fast. That's super high speed. They used to have just a big bowl, and they'd use the backwash to help lift the rocket. And that's a more dangerous way. you see the Siberian pine forest for as far as you can see, right? So that's part of the issue. It's not dense, but it's dense enough that it's hard to see things from kilometers away. So here is a from RTTV. They speed it up because they're from a different view. So it has these four towers that hold it up. This thing that pulls it up. There's a tower on the other side and a tower here, which connects the cryogenics and so forth. Much faster. Our, you know, television doesn't have much vision. Here's another time lapse from Russian television. So there's two different Russian television stations that were covering this. But you have a scale for the size of everything here. So here are the pictures of what the actual launch one does. You'll notice it's got a white thing instead of the sort of plastic wrap around it. This is the bottom, this part of the fairing. This is the bottom of the fairing. These are the parts of the rockets for the third stage. This is our satellite wrapped in its protective covering. It also will be a covering that protects the satellite. So when you're in orbit, you're traveling at a speed which is typically 7 kilometers per second. That's the excitation energy for oxygen, for O2 and so forth, to make it very reactive. And so usually you put like gold-coated Kapton or something like that on there to prevent it from just being eaten. If it's just plastic, oxygen will eat it up very quickly. But you can see the scale of the whole thing.
Russia's first civilian cosmodrome.
So this is launch day. You can see the decals there. So this is the morning at 5 a.m.
The launch site taken just a few minutes ago. It took 4 years to build the Vostochny Cosmodrome, which covers an area of 700 square kilometers. The rocket belongs to the Soyuz family of space vehicles. The Russian launch system is considered one.
You'll notice how sharp the flame is.
Reliable systems in the world. The launch has grabbed the attention of both NASA and the European Space Agency, with specialists from around the world closely watching the moment of the blastoff. Thousands of people living in cities and towns located in the immediate proximity of the Vostochny Cosmodrome couldn't witness the launch from special observation sites designed specifically for the event.
The first half is for the international. Now, the second half is for the domestic market.
After the first attempt of the rocket launch was delayed due to alleged technical difficulties earlier on Wednesday. President Putin was quick to react to the incident, having rebuked Russian space industry officials. Currently, all Russian space launches are conducted from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan. The Vostochny venue is supposed to provide Russia with self-reliance in that area, and that's why the project is considered to be of strategic importance. But the 4 years of construction have also been marred with financial scandals.
We haven't been paid for 4 months. Our company is ignoring us, and that's why we decided to speak directly to you. We're desperate, and we want your help.
That man is a construction worker at the Cosmodrome, and he spoke to President Putin last year during the leader's live Q&A session with the Russian public. Since then, several criminal cases were opened into embezzlement around the project.
We have to start 6 legal cases. 4 people were arrested, 2 of them are under house arrest, but if they are found guilty, they will have to swap their warm beds for prison cells. There's no doubt about that.
And the day before, it was coal prison cells. But okay, so here's a little bit more of the backstory. But so the first half was for international, the second half was for the domestic market, because this thing has been extremely over budget. Twice the directors of it have been arrested and so forth. The last guy who was arrested had a diamond-encrusted Mercedes limo that he was driving around. And so, but the thing that was interesting, so we got up really early in the morning to go watch the launch on the Wednesday, they mentioned. And, you know, we look at the feeds and we're wanting to video everything and make it all right. And a minute and a half before the launch, everything went dark, right? It turned out the computer programs had done that, but it's also their policy right at launch. They keep the videos running, but they stop all the feeds. And the reason I wanted to be video, because I assumed it was going to be a failure, that would be the only video we had, because they'd never reshow it, right? And what happened was, a minute and a half, the software system shut off the launch. And Putin had to stay another day. So he was mad. And so he announced these criminal cases that day. We launched the next day on time. That's when he gave the announcement there were the criminal cases, and the people who were still in their warm beds would have to be in coal prison cells. And this translation was a little more gentle, right? So, but it was interesting to see what the phenomenon was. And because here it is, a minute and a half before launch, everything looks like it's a go, and suddenly it goes dark, and you hear nothing for an hour, right? And then that comes up on the Roscosmos Facebook page, a thing that says the launch is delayed till tomorrow. And it's like several hours later before they say it was stopped, right? So here's another one. So here you see there's a water pool on the bottom. This is the bottom. There's this little bit of cryo stuff we had. Just before the launch, which is quite 2 minutes after this, they start spraying huge amounts of water as flame suppressants. And then the rocket engine turns on right away because they're pumping so many gallons. So let me try. I've lost control here. I don't want to make you wait through the 2 minutes. Well, let's see. I can't tell where we are. Okay, so now you can see we have a decal on. That means we're really serious. And what you'll see first is this is the gantry that provides all the cryogenic and other electrical stuff. And the computer monitoring what's going on. It disengages first. And if I knew where we were, I could tell how soon that is. Well, it doesn't tell me. I don't want you to have to sit through the whole thing. But they had a bunch of cameras set up so they could record everything at different perspectives and so forth. I still don't. 225. Oh, it's frozen. That's why it's not me. It's moving? Okay. So it's 240. It should go. I don't see it going. There, so now you see the disconnects. This goes down, it just stays there. So that's what's so impressive. The flames are so well controlled, they don't burn things up. And then this gantry goes away. So now there's only the four little ones. They start the water spray, turn the rocket on. Notice these are still blue instead of being black. These are actually very impressive sets of motors when you look at them. When you watch other launches, you'll see what an incredibly good job that the Soviet engineers did back 50 years ago. Okay, well, this goes on. It takes 8 minutes to get to orbit. That's actually pretty fast, right? So by 8 minutes, we know it got into orbit, and we don't know so much since then. Right? It just goes on for a while. Okay, we don't have to keep watching. Okay, let's talk science. Okay, back to the gamma ray burst. Why did we want to do this? Well, this is a plot of the 90 percentile, that is, where is 90% of the photons come? So this is an old slide, but this is early days of gamma ray burst. This is 90% of the photon flux comes in these timescales. So this is 1 second, 10 seconds, 100 seconds, right? So you're supposed to be drawn to the idea there's two clusters. In this direction, it's time. In this direction, it's basically hardness. That is, how much is in the 10 to 300 keV band versus the 25 to 100 keV band ratio. So this direction means shorter and harder energy spectrum. This means longer and softer, right? So it's kind of what you might expect if you had some kind of mechanism. But these circles are drawn to make you sort of think, well, there's a bunch of guys that are centered here, and there's a bunch of guys centered here. And these guys are given the name, well, LGRB, long duration gamma ray burst, and short duration gamma ray burst. So these guys have a characteristic time scale, which is on the order of a few seconds. And the short ones have a time scale, which is typical of 4/10 of a second. So what are these things, right? That was the theoretical question that's been around for quite some years. Gamma ray bursts were discovered in the 1970s by the Vela satellites, which were designed to be anti-nuclear weapon tests. So the United States had a series of secret satellites. They were designed to see if there were any countries doing nuclear tests, so that they could see if people were, you know, working secretly to do that or not. And shortly after they were up, they started detecting bursts of gamma rays that were on the timescales that would be relevant for nuclear tests. But they were able to show they came from the opposite direction from the Earth, right? So they had this discovery. They had to sit on it for some years before they were allowed to announce they made this discovery. That's you know, one of the things that happened. Okay, so now we have two theories about what these are, and one of these theories is fairly confirmed. So this is the long and the shorter gamma ray bursts. The long gamma ray bursts, there's a lot of evidence for. You have a supermassive star. The supermassive star burns up its fuel when the center is poisoned, so they cannot burn so much anymore. It's too much of higher, heavier elements. There is not enough heat to keep it from collapsing. And therefore, it collapses, and it forms a black hole, but it also forms an outward-going shockwave that blows off the separate. So, but there is some material left around. It forms a torus that spirals into the black hole. And just by conservation of momentum and other things, you end up getting two relativistic jets, back-to-back jets, that are sending out things at gammas that are anywhere from 10 to 100. Okay, so they're pretty relativistic. In that sense. And in this jet, you have not only the relativistic particles, mostly the electrons that you're really considering, you have a rich bath of photons, and these get Compton scattered by these relativistic electrons, and so they get boosted from ultraviolet and soft X-ray into the hard X-rays and gamma rays as high as GeV kind of range, right? And there can be double boosting and so forth. So you get X-rays and gamma rays. You can also get shock waves when you pass through additional materials, right? So you have both internal shocks and external shocks that are possible. So that's the idea, that there is a central engine. It's producing two jets, and it's being fed by some material. Okay, so this was an idea that's pretty reasonable, and this is an idea that's supported by the fact that several years, 15 years ago, I can't remember how long ago it was now, Beppo Sachs' X-ray satellite happened to be looking at the right direction and saw the X-ray flash from a gamma ray burst, could localize it sufficiently well that big telescopes could be used to measure spectra, and they saw that there was a supernova remnant there. Since then, there have been several supernova remnants, and they tend to be the supermassive star type supernova remnants, type 2. And so there's fairly good evidence that this model is the correct model for at least a large fraction of them, perhaps all of them. Right? Statistically, it's hard to know, but you can't prove everyone because we haven't detected everyone. Maybe as things go on, it'll be there. So what are the short ones? Okay. Well, the argument we used to make in the early days was anything that lasts less than a second can't be more than a light second across. Right? So it has to be the merger of two compact objects that somehow makes back-to-back relativistic jets, right? Or at least one relativistic jet. That's hard not to make two. So the model that most people would use is to use two compact objects, so a neutron star and a black hole, or two neutron stars as being the generator. They collide, eventually making a black hole, and there's leftover material if it's neutron stars, and the angular momentum is such that you get the jets in an automatic way. So this is the theory, but there is no direct evidence for this. That's So what you'd really like to do is have a gamma ray burst detector and an advanced LIGO with full sensitivity and see a coincidence. Of course, you'd like to see a coincidence in many other ways. Right? But so then you'd have multi-messenger astronomy. So that's the science. And this is the thing that we are interested in, was trying to understand some of this mechanism and learn something about the jets. But it turns out the jets, I've since then studied, and the jets are very much more complicated, so it's hard to say. So here's where the state of the art is. So there's about one per day of these things that are detected. You can detect them across the whole universe. So this is a cool animation of a relativistic jet. That's one with external shocks.
Shorter bursts prove much more elusive. In fact, even some of their basic properties were unknown until NASA's Swift satellite began.
So one of the reasons you have the afterglow is the jet is punching through extra material and it glows in the UV optical infrared. So this is the model of what happens.
These objects are incredibly dense. Just the sugar cube sized piece of neutron star can weigh as much as all the water in the Great Lakes. When two orbiting neutron stars collide, they merge and form a black hole, releasing enormous amounts of energy in the process.
So this is really clean, because they just merge, right? There's no extra material debris or whatever, right? But you see here in this simulation, there is a disk. So earlier simulations show that you get the accretion disk and the black hole.
Now, the simulations reveal the middle step of the process, how the merging star's magnetic field organizes itself into outwardly directed components capable of forming a jet. The Damiana supercomputer at Germany's Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics needed 6 weeks to reveal the details of a process that unfolds in just 35 thousandths of a second.
So magnetic fields in blue, the density in red.
Surrounded by superhot plasma. On the left is a map of the density of the stars as they scramble their matter into a dense hot cloud of swirling debris. On the right is a map of the magnetic fields, with blue representing magnetic strength a billion times greater than the sun's.
So the magnetic field concentrates there.
Shows the same disorderly behavior of the matter and magnetic fields. Both structures gradually become more organized, but what's important here is the white magnetic field. Amidst this incredible turmoil, the white field has taken on the character of a jet, although no matter is flowing through it when the simulation ends. Showing that chaotic magnetic fields suddenly become organized as jets provides scientists with the missing link. It confirms that merging neutron stars can indeed produce short gamma ray bursts. At this moment,
so it's really messy when you think about what the magnetic fields do, and it's complicated to calculate. But once you form that, you somehow have to have external particles going out making fields and pinching them, because a lot of these are beamed much less than 10 degrees. They're some of as small as 1 degree. So it really has to organize quite a lot. Okay, so sorry, I was one sling ahead. So here's the Swift satellite. So it's a satellite that has a gamma ray burst detector and a 30 centimeter telescope on it. And the gamma ray burst detector sees these flashes. And every now and then they swing the satellite around in time in order to actually see the afterglow. And you see a little circle going around it for how long it lasts. But you'll see only a small fraction of them are caught. So there's one. There's one that lasted a long time, and it was one of the ones that was furthest away known at that time. A couple years later, they got another one that's even further away. See, there's the one that's, you know, redshift of like 9, 8, something like that. So that's 2010. So this satellite's been up for 8 years, and by 2010, they had gotten 500 gamma ray bursts that they detected. And they had followed up, you know, they had actually seen optically and therefore localized much better. So what's the issue? The answer is, if you think about it, or if you know a little bit about spacecraft, you cannot take a big spacecraft and move it around very quickly. You're doing it by reaction wheels, and it takes typically on the order of 100 seconds to swing from an arbitrary position within the field, the third, plus or minus 30 degree field of view, over to see that image. So we had an idea, which was be simpler about it. Instead of moving, detecting here with your gamma ray burst detector and then slewing the whole spacecraft, you just slew the beam. Right? So you just a double axis gimbal mirror, you calculate where the mirror should point, and the beam, instead of being there, you move it over to where the thing was. So then the question is, how far can you gimbal and how quickly can you move it and whatever time. So that was our idea. And this is the concept of our Pathfinder. There is a bird alert telescope that's got a coated mask and a detection plane that allows you to, I'll show you how that allows you to calculate the angles, the two angles to the thing to about a half a degree. And then you have onboard processing that says, okay, move this slewing mirror to see where it is and then send that into your telescope. And there you can see it with a CCD and measure its position down to sort of the couple of arc seconds kind of level. So that's the thing. So there is a bird alert telescope and there's a slewing mirror telescope. Right? That's the acronyms are, the overall acronym is stupid, but those acronyms are simple. Okay, so here's how the coated mask work. This is moderately standard in the field. You have a uniform product code in two directions, so that you have no one's going to, and you can easily show mathematically that 50% blockage is sort of the optimum, as you throw away half of your photons in order to get the pattern. So if you have this pattern, as this checkerboard pattern, you then have a gamma ray burst that's off in the red direction. Its image of this is shifted to that side. If it's off in the blue direction, it's shifted to that side. You have your focal plane detectors here. You just do a simple cross correlation. Just multiply the pattern, this pattern, times the photon detection pattern, and you adjust it around until you get the maximum and you get the two angles. And you just have to do that very fast in order to get there in a short time period. Well, that's what microprocessors do. Okay, so here's our coated mass aperture. There's a hand over here to give you scale. This is about 50 centimeters by 50 centimeters, and it's about 50% coverage. And this is made out of tungsten. And then it's got a nice little plastic layer on the top and these frameworks so it can make it through the launch and so forth. And then it's assembled into an assembly that looks like this. So these are just a relatively thin aluminum with some stiffening spines and a bottom part which holds the bottom focal plane that you get the image of. And it's sitting there on a granite table in the clean room. Okay, so that's then designed to go on the spacecraft, and it's simple. And this is all enclosed, you'll see that. And this is here to keep us from seeing the sun because our Russian colleagues wanted an orbit where you get to see the sun a lot. So you have to make sure the sun doesn't shine on your telescope. So you have to have the shield around it, but you also have to be smart enough to move you have to have more calculation power to move your telescope over to the side so it doesn't, the mirror over the side so it doesn't bend you. So here is, at the beginning in one of the clean rooms, this is the mock-up, a plastic mock-up, and this is the telescope, and this is the slewing mirror being tested by three of the graduate students. Here is just outside, and there's a very clean room, there was a very clean room, a clean room, and then a partially clean room where we did the electronics. Here's some more of the graduate students. This was an unusual group. We had 5 women grad students and 2 men grad students. Here are the 5 women grad students at the Space Agency Assembly area. So they were called themselves a Big Mick at Istra, which is the outer one. And so the problem came after a while. So here you see the detector and the can for the telescope. So this is Ira Young. She's getting her PhD in Paris now because waiting 3 years without knowing when the Russians are going to launch you is not a good way to be a grad student. Right? That's the downside, right? So two of them went to get their degrees in France, one in Paris, one in Toulouse, and the others went off to do other projects, although Sohmen is still working on it, on the stuff these days. Okay, so we had the 20 kilograms. This is an old slide. And, you know, launch in November, launch at Christmas, launch at the next Christmas, launch at the next Christmas, launch at Easter. Okay. And we proposed to follow this up with an instrument called ZICI, almost as bad an acronym. But if you look, instead of being 20 kilograms, it's about 120 kilograms. And again, it's just a bigger X-ray coated mass, but it doesn't have to be that much bigger than we have. But a bigger telescope with more bafflings, so it's easier to deal with. And you pick a better orbit than the orbit we end up achieving, and you'll get a much better duty cycle, right? Because you can stay away from the sun, you can observe much more of the time, and so forth. So this is just the Empress visiting Lomonosov and his laboratory at what, well, Moscow State University in those days was right next to the Kremlin. Right? There's still two parts of the university there, but most of it's on the bluff overlooking the city now, and so forth. So here's the status of what's going on. Behind is the picture of the actual launch, just because at the time when I made this slide, it was all hot and new. So on May 7th, we found out that one of the satellites that went into space appeared to be doomed. It was the SAMSAT. It was one of the nanosatellites. It didn't appear to work, right? And what happened was, I think the solar cells did not deploy. It eventually ran out of power, right? They couldn't send the commands and so forth. So the Jinx satellite ceases to do that. The Lomonosov and the ICED were supposedly at that time reported functioning normally. And at that point, they deployed the antennas and the solar panels, and they started doing the telemetry and checking it out. And the Russians thought, well, we should be really careful. We'll start checking it out. We'll spend a week checking out the spacecraft and make sure it all works. Then we'll turn on the first instruments, and then we'll turn on the second, and so on. So anyway, we'll see. And they announced it began, right? So here's the last one that I got details on and so forth. So on May 11th, got the first session of transmission of scientific data. Before that was all testing. So you realize this is 2 weeks after the launch before the first science data came down. And it was from that device that's the low accelerator, little accelerometer and Dipron. Those are two, they're sort of going on. And that day, the BDRG, which is sort of X-ray, gamma ray kind of thing, was supposed to be turned on and start taking data. And I've been waiting, but unfortunately, when I was in China, I couldn't get any of my, I was in China for the last one, couldn't get any emails, but I didn't see any emails from them. But I was hoping I was going to get an update today when I sent the note in. So they were going to supposedly go through each of the instruments in turn, and ours was scheduled for being turned on about today. So I don't know. So I thought the talk was very topical. So that's where we are. No conclusion to my talk. I can stop there and answer questions. Oh, and I forgot to show you. I brought this prop in. I forgot to show you a picture that I have. Some of you will recognize this. For a long time, this was the biggest academic building in the world. This is Lomonosov, Moscow State University, with a picture with the statue of Lomonosov. This is out in front or the back, depending on what it is. I'm wearing my nuclear tie because just on the right-hand side is the Skolbysin Nuclear Institute, which is where we did the satellite testing. So, but this was by far the biggest. And you see up here on the top, this big star. Those were the original stars that were on the Kremlin and got moved out, and new ones were put on the Kremlin. And so this architecture style is referred to as Stalin's Empire, because there's two hotels and two other buildings in Moscow in the same style and so forth. But he, you know, wanted to show the rest of the world what a great country the Soviet Union, or a great system the Soviet Union was. So he had all this really impressive stuff and really built up a great university. But since the fall of the Soviet Union, they basically had no pay raises or anything for it's now 25 years almost. Okay, now questions.
So I'll ask a first question on institutions, because you started your talk sort of talking about institutions in a sense. So on the one hand, you talked about how good the engineering is and how good the space science is there. And on the other hand...
I didn't say science was good. What I said was...
Rocket science.
The Soviet scientists did amazingly well when they made those rockets. They did an incredibly good design. I tried to show you stuff. You had to watch some of the other launches from other space agencies, including when you look at SpaceX and so forth, which is really modern compared to this. Remember that Soyuz is over 50 years old. Right? I mean, the design's over 50 years old. So they had extremely good engineering and thought process putting in. I mean, what piece of equipment do you have that's 50 years old that still works great and that you are using? And they haven't done much change. They added some electronics and stuff, but it's basically the same stuff. So the metallurgy was really good, and they really cared about the stuff, and they really executed putting them together very well. And so the success rate of the Soyuz was extremely high. And if I was an astronaut going to the space station, I would have been glad to go up on the Soyuz in the old days, because your chances of survival were much better than for the shuttle. Right? We have evidence of that, right? And so for the shuttles, it's about a 4% failure rate. Whereas for the Soyuz, it was up until recently, it was less than 1% failure rate. It's extremely impressive. But think about how they engineered that so carefully, that those guys came back, right, and they didn't, you know, they just let go of it and it went up, and they just put it back up and they can launch again. They don't even have to paint the stand, right? Whereas, you know, the launches that I've been to in the U.S., the tower gets burned black. I mean, but the Russians used to do many more launches than the U.S. The Russians used to be doing like 100 launches per year, and the U.S. was doing like 20. There's a huge difference if you're just launching every couple of days, right? And, well, the Soviets used to launch at that rate. Now they primarily launch. So the other rocket they did that's very good and had a very high success rate was the Proton rocket, which is an incredibly big lift capability. And they did that for a number, they had military and other uses for a really massive payload rocket. And the Proton is still a fairly successful one, but they did have in the last 6 years some couple failures of that, right? So there was an issue, and of course the boss of that agency got fired after a couple of failures and so on. So institutionally, it's a separate question, but I mean, the Russians are still quite technically capable of doing things. They failed once they decided the Cold War was done. They failed to have a plan what to do after that. So they just kind of let things fall apart. Now Putin has been spending a lot of time and money and resources on building the military back up, which is bad news for people in Europe, and people in the periphery of Russia. But, and so some of those things they're building are quite competent, capable, right? So,
in terms of capability, how does this compare with Swift?
With Swift, this is a prototype. Okay, so there's several things. There are a couple of our colleagues made choices that I didn't agree with, and some of our Asian colleagues voted to go with them, even though I didn't think it was the right choice. But in principle, if this were in a good orbit, if say it was in a terminator orbit, so it was in the dark, looking in the dark all the time, but getting solar power, now it's in that's a sun synchronous orbit. It's in a sun synchronous orbit, so this is a problem for grad student physics students, which is what inclination orbit should you have in order to be able to keep your orbit rotating as the Earth goes around the sun, right? So it always keeps the same aspect angle of the sun. And that's a problem that was solved. So the first thing you have to do is think about what causes angular momentum precess, and the angle is the torque. So where does the torque come from? It comes from the rotation of the Earth, causing a quadrupole moment from the Earth. If you're going perfectly north-south, that quadrupole moment pulls equally on both sides. That's not. If you tilt it slightly, this side is being pulled that way, and this side is being pulled that way, so you have a torque. And so for this orbit, which is about 450 kilometers above the Earth, a 97-degree inclination orbit, 90 degrees would be right exactly polar, so 7 degrees off polar, gives you 1 degree per day precession, right? Approximately. So if you're in that orbit, you keep the same aspect angle to the sun all the time. And so our colleagues wanted an orbit in which they spent a bunch of time in the sun charging the batteries and a bunch of time in the dark so they could see extensive air showers in the really dark area, whereas we would have liked to have been at the terminator, which is great in the winter for seeing the ground and cold, but not so much. But there, the satellite would be just in the sun, barely in the sunlight, but you could look away from the sun with some shields on it, just like our shield on their thing, and you would be able to be making measurements all the time. The second issue is that if you don't have that orbit, but you would rather have an equatorial type orbit, you know, that because you don't go through the radiation belt. So in this orbit, we lose half the duty cycle because the sun's up all the time. We can't point our telescope around carefully. You know, even if we avoid the sun, there's still light coming in and changing it. But the other is we pass through because of the orbit, and I can show you the details of the orbit. So here's the takeoff of the orbit. So you're really far north, right? And you go north, right? And you go up over it. So this is where the pieces drop, right? So this is where your astronaut pieces would fall off you. But astronauts can't go to polar orbit because the space station is in not quite equatorial orbit, 30-degree orbit and so on. But this is the natural direction to go here in the polar orbit. So if you look, you launch at a reasonable time of day in Vostochny, which is 5 a.m. in Moscow. And you go up, and you actually have a low orbit, and then you boost to the higher orbits with the third stage, and you drop the different satellites off. Right? So each satellite is in a somewhat different set of orbits because they had different things they were doing. But you're putting yourself in this orbit, and if you look at it, it essentially goes over Moscow at 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. every day, approximately. But it drifts slowly. It drifts a half an hour a day because it's a 94-minute orbit instead of a 90-minute orbit. In Kobe, we did a 90-minute orbit, and so it was exactly the same time every day, which was good and bad, right? And so it's an issue there, but so this doesn't show quite the fact that it's 97 degrees, but it's whatever. But it shows when the downlinks were and so forth. But there are places in the world where there are bad, because of the Earth's magnetic field, there's a South Atlantic anomaly, and then there's the poles. Those are all radiation belts. And so if you pick the wrong orbit, you'll go through all those radiation belts, most every orbit, or some good fraction of it. That cuts the duty cycle quite far down. So I'm guessing the duty cycle will be about 10%, in which case that means to me we will get about five, if things are working right, we'll get about five events per year that will actually slew to sea. Now, that's not trivial, but you could have had 50 events per year, and that would have been really, really different. So, but this satellite is the pathfinder, right? You want something six times bigger and a better orbit. You should do better. And there you should be able to see gamma ray burst out to a redshift of about 12, which makes there's a lot of science you can do. So I didn't cover that part of science because I didn't know people were interested. But one of the questions is, how do the elements build up over time? And so there was always kind of a generic theory, just like we used to say, there'll be not very many 30 solar mass black holes before this gravitational wave things, because stars, 100 solar mass stars, they're going to blow away a bunch in their stellar wind, and when the supernova goes off, they throw out, and there'll be 5 and 10 solar mass stars. Now we got 2 30 solar mass stars making it. It means that stellar evolution theories guys were wrong. There's a lot more of those than you would think, and we'll see what's happening. There's rumors there's a second event, and so we'll see when that gets published. But if it's that common, you expect to see quite the stellar evolution kind of stuff is wrong. But anyway, it's hard to say exactly, but you kind of think that you could see quite a lot more. But the idea also has always been that you have a first generation of stars, which are difficult to make, and they have to be very massive. Your problem is, if your primary material is hydrogen and helium, to get that to collapse, you don't have effective ways of radiating. If you have carbon, there's a carbon 2 line. There are lines of some of the heavier elements that let you dissipate heat and therefore collapse. So to make lower mass stars, you need to have those heavier elements, or what we consider the middleweight elements. So to get those first generation stars, you need either very big overdensities, or you need to have them fairly massive, so that they kind of hold together while the heat very slowly radiates away from the hydrogen, or you need some extra mechanism for doing that. And so the idea is the first generation stars, which astronomers foolishly call population 3 stars, they are mostly the hydrogen. Of course, they're naturally hydrogen helium, but they're more massive. They burn very rapidly because they have a lot higher pressure. Therefore, the density is higher. The reaction rate goes as the density squared, so that's going to be proportional to the mass. And the temperature is going to be higher, so it's going to be proportional like the third power of the mass. I forget, it's third or the fifth power. I've forgotten which way it goes. And so they burn much more quickly. So a 100 solar mass star would be burned up in 10 million years. Right, and then it'll vent elements, and then it will supernova out a bunch of elements, and that'll make your first generation that allows you to make the next generation stars. And eventually you need to make those heavier elements in order to make planets. Right, so our theory of how planets made is they're all rocky cores, so you had to have rocks, you have stuff to make a rock, you have to have some silicon and stuff. And then if you're outside the freezing zone, you can adhere water. So it's no accident that Jupiter is the heaviest element in the solar system because it's just outside the freezing zone, so it would gather the most water, right? And then, you know, Saturn is next and so on. That's your theory of how, your simple theory of how planets should form. Rocky core, adhere water. If the water freezes, you can keep it. If it's not frozen, you don't get it and you get a light planet, right? And so, of course, finding all these extrasolar planets means we're going to get to see whether that's right or not, because it's clear some of the heavy planets have moved in. Right? So the question is, were they formed outside or were they formed inside, and we don't understand the mechanism. So it's always been assumed that if you look as a function of redshift, the what astronomers call a metallicity, that is the fraction of carbon, nitrogen, oxygen on higher elements, will increase steadily with redshift because you're just continuing the process. And what I don't have here, but I can show you another, is there was a gamma ray burst at a redshift of about 3.8 or something like that, which passed through light from its own galaxy and from a nearby galaxy, but along the line of sight. And you can see the absorption lines of the elements, and you can see it's almost near solar system abundance. So back at a redshift of 4, right, approximately, you were having places were that way. And so if you look more carefully, think about the theory more, the abundance of heavier elements should be proportional to the richness of the cluster and the richness of the material from which the stars form, because you get more stars faster and you burn faster. You know, so now you have to come up with it's a more complicated model. It's like the neutron star, but bad. Worst complication thing to do. So you would like to be looking at these supernova and finding a location, these gamma ray bursts, finding a location and see them right away with a big ground-based telescope where you can measure the spectra, because then you can actually measure the time to redshift. But the other thing you can do is determine when the first generation of stars come up. So it was a big controversy. So when the WMAP data first came out, because of various area and because of misinterpreting the Lyman Alpha Forest data, early Lyman Alpha Forest data, people were thinking radiation could have happened as early as a redshift of 30. Now, and that gave a tau, which was greater than a tenth. That is, the reionization, you know, the electron fraction of scattering gave a tau of about a tenth of a percent. And so there was a lot of effort done in those days to try and see how you can make a first generation of early stars. Now, about 2 weeks ago, we had a Planck paper out where the polarization data from the high-frequency instrument was recalibrated, and now the limit on tau is approaching 0.04. It's about 0.05 right now. But it's a big step down, but it's detected. It's not a one-sided thing. It's a sort of a detected thing. And that's telling you that the first generation of stars is probably not nearly as early. It might. So the question is it a redshift of 15? Is it a redshift of 10 or 12 or whatever? What's the first generation? I mean, it always could be some outliers that happened early, but when did the first really main massive set of stars come up? And so with the gamma ray bursts, if you could detect them with something like Seeky, you could start doing the statistics of when, you know, what does the turn on curve look? Because you expect a big burst of long gamma ray, of the long gamma ray burst, and not so far behind that of the short gamma ray burst, because that's compact objects doing it. So there's some end spiral time, and there's a distribution of delays, but sort of a giga year could be sort of the typical time scale, but less than that. You could measure that and see what that profile is in somewhat of a direct way, but you can also then try and measure how the elements build up. Now, so that's not interesting to people who are doing sort of big scale cosmology, but it's interesting to the people who are doing, you know, things like how, when do planets form, when this, you know, when the conditions for life start coming into existence, what's the real stellar evolution kind of stuff. And it's the kind of thing where as we're getting more and more accurate with these measurements, that to fit the make the corrections and do the cosmology really precisely, you need to put some of these corrections in or something like that. So there are interesting things you could do if you would do that. So now we just got to find somebody who's got enough money to build, you know, the 10 times bigger or 6 times bigger one, because Swift is on its last leg. If it hadn't died, or it may have died, I don't remember, but it's down to the point where it's operating on one gyro, and so it's limited in what it can do. But it's been up there a very long time. But the problem is there's no mission coming behind it and no compelling things to do. And the other problem you have is astronomers, when gamma ray bursts were new, were very glad to give time for people to look follow up. But now they don't want to interrupt their observations, because unless it's a gamma ray burst that has something special about it. And so unless you can locate it and localize it very well, and you can say, yes, this was in a high redshift or something like that, they're less loath, you know, they're loath to interrupt ongoing observations to slew over and look at gamma ray bursts. Now, there's a new generation of robotic telescopes coming, which may be capable of doing that, but they're not in place yet. And so you need a system that lets you detect the gamma ray burst, localize it, and do it. Now, with the gravity waves, in principle, if those 30 solar mass black holes are relatively common, ELISA should be able to see them for about 10 years before they coalesce. They should see them from 10 years to about a week before they coalesce. And if you were able to observe it for that time period, you can probably localize them to about a degree and predict to within 10 seconds when they're going to happen. So you can tell people where to look and when to look. And if you were able to put up two ELISAs, you can do better than that, right? Because there you're depending on, you know, doing super resolution with your beam, because the beam for a single gravity detector is quite broad, so you have to measure very precisely. But if you have two gravity wave detectors, that here's the Earth going around the Sun, you put them on either side like that, you have this long baseline, so you can do that. You get this narrow arc where the thing can come from, and as you go around the Sun, you pivot that, and there'll be a place that it pulls out pretty well. So if you were really smart and really rich, you'd put up two leases, you know, one preceding the Earth and one following the Earth, and you would do that. But you'd still like to have, you know, one of these gamma ray burst detectors with a slewing mirror, so that you could localize it enough to slew great big ground-based telescopes. Most big ground-based telescopes on the Hubble have extremely narrow field of view. If you don't tell them to better, you know, to sort of much better an arc-minute scale, they can't find it, right? And there's way too many things in the field of view that confuses them. And if you want spectroscopy, you need to, unless it's a multi-fiber system with robots, it's not going to be able to figure out which one to do. So you need something like this. So now that this thing is up, and if it actually turns on and it works, I'm not expecting a huge amount of scientific results, but what it means is now it's incumbent on people thinking, well, can we actually build a big one that will do the job right? And that's much more ambitious and so forth. But on the other hand, if you've sort of shown it and it works, and you've got gravity waves and other things going on, it becomes more interesting. What's the lifetime of this? It started as a really short-term project where we're going to build it in a year and a half and we're going to launch it and have it run.
Forget that part.
For the Russian satellites, they sort of have a policy of turning them off after 2 years. And that comes from the Soviet era when they were really launching like 100 things a year and they couldn't do it. Now, what's happened is the Russians actually have a ground station colleagues, collaborators, have a ground station. So this is one of the things that we do in space science is depending on NASA, do something. So you can run your own ground station for much less cost than the government does. And if you can convince them to spend a certain amount of money, then you can run your satellites many more years, right? So they have their own ground station, but it's a question of how reliable, how long it runs. And that's why I'm nervous that they're waiting 3 weeks to turn this thing on, because it would be nice to know it actually survived the launch and it can slew the mirror. Now, one of the things I tried to convince my colleagues, we should have a thing where we slewed it to look at the moon and we slewed it to look at some known stars and stuff like that, so we could prove that slewing mirror works, even if some of the other stuff didn't work. But, you know, that was a... They couldn't imagine that things could go wrong, so we'll see. But, you know, once you sort of know it works, then the question is, how can you put together one that's really well designed and good and find somebody to launch it, right? Because then it's a useful thing for doing, you know, setting up to doing serious science in the future, and also because there is no follow-up made for Swift satellite. I mean, almost all the space agencies have clogged themselves up with big missions, and the money's gone science. So the Hubble, the James Webb Space Telescope, has pretty much killed astrophysics in the United States for a period that was about 20 years, right? And so 2018, it's supposed to launch an open wedge, but the only wedge is for, I forget the name of it now, it's the supernova, and, you know, it's the dark energy plus planet finder, right? W-FIRST, sorry. So the only one that's on the list is the new mission is W-FIRST. And that's been for a very long time. It's just kept growing and going over budget, and they're trying to keep it from absorbing the other parts of astrophysics. You know, well, everything called astrophysics has been eaten up by James Webb. It's the solar space physics and the other stuff that they're trying to protect from it. So those guys have still been getting missions. But astrophysics has basically had no missions, and the problem is that means there's no new generation being trained for doing these kind of missions. Right? So if you know somebody who's rich that wants to put up some money, that's unfortunate thing is a lot of science these days is done by private donation, right? It's not being government supported properly. Did I answer you guys' questions enough? There's only one question. I was hoping you found the politics on the, you know, you were saying it's a little strange to criticize Putin in the thing, but, you know, those poor grad students, if you think about it, if you're a grad student and you're sitting there waiting for 3 years for your thesis, it's just not viable, right?
There's ones who are less fortunate. The ones you, after many years, launched and then exploded.
Right.
There's few of those, right? Out there.
But you know. Understand, I mean, I was sanguine about it because this is the launch from Vostochny to prove that he spent many billions making this place, to prove that that wasn't wasted money, to keep it's a domestic message where he's standing there with a rocket gun up over his shoulder, right? That it's extremely a domestic message, and the fact that he's prosecuting the people who were stealing the money, right? That's also a domestic message, right? And, but he hasn't been supporting science very much. But on the other hand, he's been supporting building this cosmodrome and also building up the military quite substantially.
Okay, so let's thank George again.